We're back.
I loved it. Your cat tried to drink my drink.
Oh man.
Anyway,
we're doing it again.
We are back.
For some reason, I feel a little low, but okay.
Turn it up, mate.
Yeah.
Hear yourself.
We've seen more movies.
We have.
It's another week, another episode.
I agree.
We're still here.
We're surviving, man. You know, speaking of that, just real quick, prayers up, rest in peace, John Amos, man.
Rest in peace, John Amos.
Yeah, man. Hollywood legend.
Yeah.
So the films.
Someone posted on Instagram, I guess, the day it happened, or I don't know. It seemed like it happened a while ago.
It happened a while. They pulled an MF Doom. They waited a few weeks.
Okay. I was like, because when I looked it up, I was like, why did someone just post about it now? But they posted that scene where she's in the Florida's in the kitchen and she breaks the glass.
damn.
Classic. But yeah.
Classic. We're back. How you feeling, man?
I feel pretty good.
These two movies, you know, yes. You bet you had a good time, I'm imagining.
So first, you recommended
Happy Campers.
Happy Campers.
2001?
2001.
Yeah.
It was pretty interesting. I did enjoy it. I thought it was, I think if you look it up, it was like a 5.7 rating.
Yeah. It got like, trashed.
Oh, damn, it's pretty low, but I didn't think it was terrible. What did you like about it?
So I recommended this movie to you because when we had that conversation and you like to say you like little stories. Well, I coined that term, yeah. I guess.
Or you say you that did. About the movies I recommend.
Right. But they're very like, they're not on a grand scale movies. There's nothing impacting the world at large, you know. And I thought about this movie I saw as a kid that we had on VHS called Happy Campers. We didn't even have a cover for it. It was just the tape. And when I used to watch it, I thought it was a good coming of age story, kind of like a twisted version of like an American Pie type movie, but not sure. So corny.
Yeah.
You know, and like there were serious stakes at points and
yeah.
You know, things got a little it was a tonal shift, like
yeah.
I thought it was interesting in that way and it was a small enough story to where I was like maybe my man can get something out of this.
Yeah. I did enjoy it. Like you say, it's a coming of age movie and I do like those types of stories. I did go to summer camps, you know, as a younger man, but I think mine were all like guy only, if I remember correctly.
Okay.
And it was like more Christian themed or whatever.
Okay.
But I think the main thing that I kind of didn't like about it is that it tried to do too much, too many characters, like everybody kind of getting their own story. So it's kind of like, you know, when you're trying to make me care about everyone, I don't end up caring about anyone because it's like once you start to get a little bit engaged in what's happening over here, they have to cut to over here, the story, you know what I mean? But
did they not execute it well, you think? Because I mean, Tarantino does that. He'll give you a bunch of characters and maybe it wasn't well executed.
I guess it just felt like no one's story really
mattered,
like came to like a full close.
Oh, okay. So this is a script. I don't know.
Yeah, it was just a little too much. Like maybe right. If it was like it
wasn't tight,
a fewer counselors that you were supposed to care about and a fewer you know camp goers, it probably would have been a little bit better. But all in all, I would say I enjoyed it, you know. I didn't hate it. Some of the stuff was like a little, like all the stuff that they did in the woods, like with the blue light. I don't know if you remember that.
Yeah.
I thought it was a little too much, but.
Too early 2000s, you think?
Yeah.
Yeah.
But, and then I kind of thought like, it kind of reminded me of some other movies. Like it kind of reminded me of this one movie, Streamers, that I've told you about, that it's pretty good. A Robert Altman movie about like all these soldiers living in, the barracks before Korea, and it's like you know, there's a black one, a gay one, and like it's a bunch of guys, you know, like in their early 20s, right before the war. So just like tension.
Yeah. That's okay.
Yeah.
I would like to see that.
Yeah. It's really good. I think it was shot in Dallas too. Even though it doesn't really matter. It's just like all inside that location for the most part.
You know, we love our shot in Dallas films.
Yeah.
What'd you think about, cause like to me, I thought the movie had like a few main players, if not main characters, like the Wichita guy.
Wichita, and I think Wendy.
Wendy. Pixel. I thought those were the two like lead ones, and then of course the sexy young lady who was in
the temptress or whatever. Pixel, I think her name was.
Pixel, yeah. So
I don't know, like I thought it was fine. It's just like,
was it forgettable for you?
I just feel like there's so many movies in that genre, like the coming of age and
right.
like movies and shows, you know what I mean? Like, I would like something like a, Freaks and Geeks.
Right. Right.
Or like a Ghost World, you know,
this felt like a mix of Freaks and Geeks and like an American Pie to me. And that's what I think I found alluring about it.
Kind of reminded me of Heavyweights too. You remember that one?
Heavyweights, yeah.
With Ben Stiller at the fat camp.
Yeah.
Okay,
well, would you give it 0 to 100?
For this one, I felt like if it was a 5.7, I thought that was a little low.
Mm-hmm.
I'm going to give it a nice little 65.
All right. I'm not mad at that.
Six being like baseline, good movie, worth watching.
Mm-hmm. I'm never mad at that, because this isn't, you know, this isn't your, obviously this movie wasn't successful.
Yeah.
You know, and this isn't something people ran out to see, but it's still a good watch, I think.
Yeah.
You know, not
kind of like what I mean with like having too many characters to like really fulfill. Like if you remember like the little gay kid.
Yeah.
Who like comes out to like the older gay kid.
Mm-hmm.
Like I just felt like both of those characters were like, they kind of wanted you to feel like they're important characters, but they didn't give them any development.
Okay.
With like, I think it was Brandon Lee. Like he's like the only one who kind of went on to really.
Maybe.
The guy who's been in like Tusk and like Zach and Miri.
Yeah. Him, yeah.
Who was like the nerdy guy and even like the nerdy girl. Have you seen Can't Hardly Wait?
No, I haven't. No.
I've seen that one a little too much, but it's another like kind of high school movie. It's got Seth Green in it.
Oh shoot.
And it's actually pretty good. But I felt like that's kind of also does like, but I think that's kind of just like a high school party type of thing. It's like, or even like a Dazed and Confused classic example.
Dazed and Confused classic.
Yeah. So it's like, this is such a tough genre, you know what I mean? It's almost like when people
it's kind of overwhelming, overstuffed,
like with war movies, you know, you can even if you have a good war movie, it's like such a stuffed genre that it's like you know, it's easy to be overlooked.
Right I can see that. I understand that. That's why like maybe like if you make a good horror film, it stands out. If you make a good sci-fi film, it kind of stands out.
Yeah,
maybe not with sci-fi.
Yeah, I mean, it's a lot of movies in every genre, so anyways. Yeah.
All right, well, I ain't mad at that score. I like that. So, what about this happiness, man?
Yeah, the next movie.
Woo! My boy!
I guess my pick was Happiness, 1998.
What were you thinking when you recommended this?
So, I think I've said before, I like to watch movies that I kind of don't know anything about. I just kind of know that they're interesting, or someone says that they're good, you know. It's like the less I know the better. So all I had really seen, like I had heard that this was an NC-17 movie, which already it's like, okay, yeah, makes me want to check it out.
Mm-hmm.
And then I saw the poster, and for a while I thought it was animated because the poster is like animated.
Yeah, it looks like Mike Judge.
And then I saw like on Instagram, you know, you'll see like movie scenes. It was the scene where Philip Seymour Hoffman is on the phone and he's like with Joy.
Yeah.
And she's in the kitchen.
Uh-huh.
And she's like, oh, I got your number from my sister, you know, and it's like going so well. And then he he's like, oh, what are you wearing? She's like, oh, you know, just some jeans. And like, are they tight?
I'm tight.
I love that.
And she's like, no, they actually fit pretty well. So, yeah, I saw that scene on Instagram, and I was just like, yeah, this movie looks interesting.
Interesting.
Let me add it to the watch list. And so I'm happy we watched it together.
Yeah, that was good.
It's definitely the kind of movie where it's like,
you need someone to believe it.
Yeah, it's like so weirdly uncomfortable that you're just like, it's nice to have someone to look at to just be like, is this really happening?
I tried to explain it to my coworkers, and they were like, so the movie's about a pedophile? And I was like, oh, God, y'all just got to experience it.
And that's kind of funny, too. I was thinking like that I recommended you Lolita like last episode and then this. I'm like, wow. But
what's going on there, bud?
I mean, did you enjoy the movie?
Yeah, I'm a fan.
Yeah,
of the movie, not a fan.
Yeah, so Todd Solondz, the director's name.
Todd Solondz, huh?
I looked up some of the trivia. One of the interesting things I thought that I didn't realize until seeing it was Philip Seymour Hoffman and Ben Gazzara are both in this movie.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Even though they don't share any screen time, they're both also in Big Lebowski.
Ah.
I thought that was pretty cool.
I loved Ben Gazzara in this.
Yeah, he was really cool.
It was refreshing to see him. I hadn't looked up the movie or the cast before.
Yeah, same. I saw that John Lovitz was in it.
Right.
He was awesome.
He was great. He was great as well.
I think I got a sample from his little scene at the beginning.
Mm-hmm. You think I'm shit? Well, you're wrong. Because I'm champagne. And you're shit.
That was great delivery.
Yeah. That his whole little scene was perfect. Mm-hmm. I hate that he was only in it for that, but it was perfect.
It was perfect to me too.
This was a really weird movie.
Oh, thank you for saying that.
Upon thinking about it more and more, like, I feel like it's kind of a perfect parody of, like, you remember all those, like, special episodes?
Yeah.
Like, they basically...
PSA type episodes.
Yeah, with, like, they took one of those and they were like, let's actually go there where, like, TV would never let you go. Not, like, just hint at the fact that there's horrible things happening in the world. Like, let's actually show you the type of people that do it.
That do it and what they think about. This is that Different Strokes episode with Gary Coleman.
Yeah, exactly.
But to the extreme.
I
thought it was amazing. But
You know. Same. Very uncomfortable. I mean,
I was uncomfortable.
I have to give it up for, and shocking, you know what I mean? In a world where you almost feel like nothing is shocking anymore.
Yeah.
I
think the music made it more uncomfortable for me.
Yes. Very. I was watching a film essay about it earlier, and they used the perfect word, schmaltzy.
Schmaltzy.
And I was just like, yes, like very reminiscent of those sitcoms of like
whimsical
Full House, you know, Family Matters. And they actually put a quote from Roger Ebert that was like, I thought the perfect way to describe the movie. He said, whenever a serial killer or predator is arrested, we turn to the paper to find his neighbor saying that the monster seemed like everyone else. Happiness is a movie about closed doors and the doors of the unconscious. It shows us people that want to be loved and who will never be because they are emotional incompetence and arrested development. There are lots of people who do find love and fulfillment, but they are not in this movie.
Okay. I see that. I can see that.
I thought that was really interesting. Kind of something I wasn't even thinking about when watching it. And I did watch. That wasn't in the Siskel and Ebert review. Like, there's a clip where they review it.
Yeah.
And they kind of talk about in their review how it's like the arrested development type of thing. How they kind of talk about how Freudian it is. Like, you know, the psychiatrist who's secretly a pedophile. And
yes,
like,
yes.
They kind of talk about how...
That was incredible.
It's... because I mean, I guess because of, like, repression or whatever, that they're in these situations. And just like the way that they deliver it, like it was very thought provoking and like the thing that I was thinking after it was like, how did he even think to like
make this shit?
Make it, and also like the actor who who ultimately like played the
Dylan Baker?
Yeah, Dylan Baker.
Bill Maplewood like is the character.
Why would he wanna to play that character?
I think this is like a one of those auteur things. Like
even like the kids, I'm like the kid who was eating like the tuna salad, I'm like, how does he feel about this watching it now, like that he's grown up, like
or the son?
Yeah, like
let's talk Timmy Maplewood. Let's talk about Timmy. Man. Oh my
gosh. Did I get the same? I think I had.
Please hit something. Let's see.
I fucked them.
I fucked them. Okay. Yo, we gotta load up the drums next time.
Oh man.
But I what I liked about this film, because if there is something to like, because it makes you uncomfortable, it reminded me of Lolita. So I see what you're doing. You just hit me where it hurts.
I mean, I guess I hadn't said, but I hadn't seen it.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, I guess I kind of implied I had only seen that Philip Seymour Hoffman scene.
Mm-hmm.
But yeah, I like that. I didn't know anything about it, and it was all like as shocking to me.
I like movies that deal with the mind of someone that society would call reprehensible, and even I would call reprehensible. So even though you think it's disgusting, the mind of a pedophile in film form, I believe, can be interesting. Anything can be interesting once you put it to film and you know make a story around it. And I just found that interesting, the interaction with the son. Like,
yeah, but also kind of what I said last time, like I think I said something about Alex and Humbert, how Kubrick humanizes, you know,
the
worst type of people. It also happens in this, like even like all the conversations that he has with the son,
yeah,
as weird and uncomfortable as they are, it's like they have that schmaltzy music that like makes you feel like he does care. He is trying to be a good dad.
Yeah, but the things he says are like...
But it's just like such a perversion.
You ever practice beating off?
Like, it's such a perversion.
You need me to show you?
Oh, man.
Like, that was extreme.
Another thing from that same film essay that the guy who actually made the video said, Todd Solondz's film masterfully amplifies the underlying dysfunction of American traditionalism.
Yeah, I see what you mean.
I was just like, oh, man, that's so... it right on the head, you know what I mean? And yeah, I don't know, it just makes you think about a lot of different stuff. Like,
well, I loved Philip Seymour Hoffman in the film because he plays such an excellent creep, and I loved how in the end he was just a weakling, you know, he was just all talk,
yeah,
you know, when he actually got a chance to, you know, spoilers,
to act on
his rape urge.
Yeah.
You know, all that shit he was talking, he's actually a weakling. He doesn't, you know, he's pussified. And ironically, that's what doesn't get him the girl. You know, she's like, she was strange as well. Let's just talk about her, I mean, too.
Every character,
they had like, their thing. Had
their flaws or whatever. I feel like Joy was probably the character that's like, you kind of root for the most, because it's like,
I love that guy that did her wrong though. That Vlad. Irish Vlad, yeah, Russian. Yeah, Jared Harris. I
was
trying to find
the clip where he was like, "Are you lesbian?" I like lesbian. Yeah, he was pretty funny.
He ruled. I'll give it to him.
He's not really Russian, is he?
I don't know. His name's Jared Harris. So probably not. No, probably not. Yeah.
Yeah, but I did. They did have like a little clip of the scene where the wife comes to the job where she's like teaching them English, and she's like, "You know Vlad," and she just spits right in her face.
Like, she beats
her hair. Yeah, that was awesome. All in all, really good movie. Made me want to check out what this director has up his sleeve. I watched a short little interview with him where he was kind of talking about it. And yeah, he seems like a pretty interesting guy. I mean, definitely kind of a
abstract mind.
Interested in like the weirder side of
topics
of what's going on, you know,
yeah,
pushing
yeah.
the boundaries of what's possible.
Yeah.
And that I always find that type of stuff inspiring. You know what I mean? Like,
yeah, true.
Anything that pushes the boundaries of like what's acceptable, what can be done with the medium. It just makes you want to do something that's like that, you know, that'll make people think and talk in the future about whether it's right, whether it's wrong, you know what I mean? If it has merits, if it's enjoyable, you know what I mean?
It's pretty thought-provoking. This movie reminded me of American Beauty, but if American Beauty got to be an NC-17.
Got to actually, like, take it
take
serious.
It there, take
yeah.
it serious, you know what I mean?
For sure, like, the way all the storylines are kind of separate but looped together.
Yeah. You know?
And I always feel like that's kind of a... It's dangerous because it's like it can be, if it doesn't work, it just sucks. You know what I mean?
Yeah, it'll suck.
Like I kind of been wanting to rewatch Crash.
Okay.
Because I feel like that's kind of a lot of people like it, but then there's a lot of people who are like, that's the biggest Oscar snub in history. At the same time, there are some people who kind of say like,
I recently watched it. Yeah.
The way that they intertwine all the plots is a little cheesy. Some people like it. So all
right, that'd be a good rewatch. Yeah.
Yeah. But yeah, I guess overall, it's if you had to give Happiness a score.
I know a lot of people are going to be freaked out by this, but I'd probably give it a 90.
Damn, yeah. That's,
you know, because I didn't find anything wrong with it. I like subject matter that challenges your viewpoints and makes you, it's something interesting. It's like reading a book, you know, you get into the mind of a character that
sure.
you would never have wanted to or even thought of. So it's a very thought-provoking film. Great performances. Philip Seymour Hoffman was amazing. So a 90 for me.
90 is like near perfect. I'm going to give it a nice, cool 84.
Okay.
I like a nice, cool 84.
I was originally thinking 85, but I had to think like, I found nothing wrong with the film, and that's big for me. Like great performances, great story, kept me engaged.
It might just be arbitrary, like a matter of taste, but I kind of don't love movies that do like the multiple storyline type of things.
Okay.
Like, and even in this one, like the relationship between like, these people didn't necessarily have to know each other, you know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
And also, like, some of the storylines were just more interesting than others, you know? Like, the Ben Gazzara one with the side piece and his wife was, like, not as strong as, like, Philip Seymour Hoffman one or the main one with, like, the pedophile.
I love watching Ben Gazzara, though.
Yeah. Yeah, he's just awesome, though.
He's just awesome.
He's just, like, such a cool guy. And mm-hmm. even...
Cool asshole, too.
Yeah, like, even as he's older in this, it's just like, oh. But, yeah. I also saw this little clip that kind of reminded me one of the hilarious lines when he's, like, in bed with his wife.
Uh-huh.
And he's kind of confessing. And he's like, I'm sick. And she's like, oh, get a Tylenol. It's just like, oh, that's so perfect.
Oh, he's trying to confess. Man, he, if we're talking about Maplewood.
Bill Lumberg?
Wow, what a strong character. Strong character.
I fucked them.
Okay, so what'd you think about that scene? I'm going to say that was one of my favorite scenes. That was an incredible fucking nasty-ass scene, dude.
Yeah, it was very... I mean, it was kind of like the peak of the uncomfortability.
Yes.
I did also mark down on my trivia that Sundance did not screen this film. They refused.
Oh, wow. It was that controversial.
Yeah.
I love that scene because he was like, Dad, what'd you do to Johnny Grasso? And he tried to, you know, lay it on him smooth. Yeah. I fondled him. What does that mean? We made love. What does that mean? Hit it.
You think I'm shit?
No.
You think I'm shit?
technical difficulties.
We made
but
love.
He's champagne.
What does that mean?
I fucked
and your shit.
I fucked them. I fucked them. I fucked them.
This is so wrong.
I fucked them. I fucked them.
Yeah. What'd you think of the kid in that? Oh man, that scene, it was so creepy. His kid, you know, when it's all said and done, he's on the patio and he's beating it, and he busts on the railing of the patio. Oh, yeah. And the dog licks it.
Yeah,
kisses his aunt.
No, I was gonna say, I also like the, even though it was a small part, the dad of the kid who gets molested.
Mm-hmm.
And then what he calls,
oh, in a hospital,
you're dead.
Yeah.
That kind of, there's another movie that kind of reminded me of called Trees Lounge.
Okay,
I never watched recently. It. It was Steve Buscemi's directorial debut, and he's in it. He plays like this piece of crap guy who works. I think he works at a bar.
Really,
I forget. But yeah, it's a pretty, or he just goes to this bar called the Trees Lounge a bunch. But you have anything else to say before we?
I think if
put
people
a bow
are
on happiness and happy campers,
I think if people are apprehensive about watching happiness, I think you should check it out anyway, because you know movies are, a lot of movies are made to challenge you. Yeah. And you know, some movies make you uncomfortable, and I think this is another one of those that, kind of like Lolita, it delves into the mind of a person with a particular and maybe an antagonistic lifestyle, I would guess. And I think it's interesting to learn about these people.
Yeah, it's like you can kind of sometimes ignore the fact that
it's out there.
People like that exist, because it's like, you know, ignorance is bliss, and you don't necessarily, I mean, but also it kind of made me think, you know, have you noticed like the trend of all of these like perv catcher accounts and stuff like that? Like,
yeah, that's like, it's so big on YouTube.
So it is like, people are fascinated with the idea of this type of behavior, but they want it one way.
Yeah.
They only want to see the person portrayed as like the evil,
all the way evil,
getting smacked in Walmart, getting yelled at, you know what I mean?
But yeah. They never go by, like, what's behind that person, or
they
what?
Never show that, like, oh, it's a guy with a son and a wife, and
yeah,
he could be a psychiatrist, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
Who appears to just be a normal citizen, you know what I mean? Like, but
all kind of people out there. But hey, man,
yeah,
I think, you know, good recommendation from you. I like to think maybe you enjoyed the film I recommended as well.
Even. I did.
So we'll be back next week
for more.
This is all my screen.
Oh, please play with that. I fucked it. I fucked it.
You think I'm shit? Well, you're wrong. Well, you're wrong. Well, you're wrong. Well, you're wrong. Because I'm champagne. I'm champagne. And your shit. Your shit.
Until next time.